driving.
For the call to worship this morning, I'd like to read from Colossians chapter 3, verses 16 through 18, page 1064, if you're using a church Bible. Colossians 3, verses 16 through 18. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Let's have a word of prayer. Please stand. Father, we gather this morning that the word of Christ would dwell richly in us. And we gather to sing songs and make melody in our hearts. And we pray, Lord, that as we do that this morning, that you would stir our souls, that you would receive our worship, that you would impart a blessing, bring renewed joy and peace to our hearts this hour, this day. We give you your people that are here. Give you myself here as we worship this morning. And God's people said, amen. You may be seated. So, welcome, church. Welcome this hour, this day. Please turn off your cell phones if you haven't done so already. Greatly appreciate that, or at least put them on manner mode. announcements. We have prayer and Bible study this coming Wednesday, Genesis 41. We're in Genesis 41. Also, last night we had our annual business meeting. Appreciate those who were able to be in attendance and participated in any way to make the business meeting possible. Your labor for the Lord and this fellowship is not in vain. Also, Sandy, do we have copies?
I only have one of each. I put them in the yellow folder.
Okay.
But I'll have one.
Okay, so we will have copies of the voted 2022 budget for you.
And the info from 2021 also.
Okay, and the info from, the year-end report as well. And we appreciate Sandy doing all that hard work to get us financial reporting. That's pretty much it. Anything else for the good of the congregation this morning? Anything else? Yes, Jerry, please.
Two things. One is there's a new and updated birthday and anniversary list. Some are at each door, at each entrance, if you're interested. And also, I will be speaking to some of you, but if you're on a ministry team or a committee, we have about 3 weeks from today to get together and decide who's going to chair those committees or teams. And if you decide that within your group, please notify me, and then we can publish that. Thank you.
Okay. Also, we welcome Bill and Paulette Hurley into membership. And then also Bill and Drew are also on the elder team. So we welcome you guys. I appreciate that. So I understand that Bob Ganaway is a little bit under the weather this morning. So I'm going to introduce the next song. I'm not going to lead the next song. If anybody has song leading capability, you're more than welcome to come up and take Bob's place. But we're going to sing number 492 at Calvary. 492, please stand.
Bird. may be seated.
For the offertory thought this morning, I'd like to read from Proverbs 30, verses 7 through 9. Just love this. Two things I ask of you. Do not refuse me before I die, to keep deception and lies far from me. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with the food that is my portion, that I might not be full and deny you and say, who is the Lord? Or that I not be in want and steal and profane the name of my God. Bob, Dave, please come forward. Bill Hurley, would you lead us in a word of prayer this morning, please?
Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you this morning and to give back to you the plenty that you have provided to all of us. We thank you again for this day. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Folks, before I lead in a word of prayer, I remind you of Sam Johnson. Also be mindful of Bob Ganaway. Helen, nice to see you. Helen had foot surgery this past the other week. And pray for her healing. Remind you to look at the people in the back of the bulletin. Lots of prayer chain emails go out for various needs as well. And also, I guess some of you were inquiring or asking about Brett. So we actually had a chance to talk to Brett. He's on a ship right off the coast of Puerto Rico. He said it was pretty balmy down there on the deck, short sleeve, you know, playing basketball on the deck in their free time. I guess they have a basketball court on the deck. You know, got a little too much sunburned, you know, playing with his shirt off. So life is really tough down there on the ship. So we told him that we would pray for him, right? anyway.
Can you pray for us?
Yeah. Anyway, so Brett's doing well, and he sends his love and regards. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your eternal presence. And I think of what King David said, if I go to the highest mountain, you're there, the remotest part of the earth, you're there, or to the deepest part of the ocean, there you will find us. And So we thank you for your eternal presence, and we thank you that we have a relationship with you through the Lord Jesus Christ. We're found in the Beloved. We're found in Jesus Christ our Lord. And so we can find great comfort this morning as we bow our heads and seek your face and worship. And we thank you for your presence, and we thank you for the comfort that you bring, and we thank you for the promise that you'll always be by our side. You'll never leave us nor forsake us. And wonderful, wonderful promises, Lord. We pray that we would not fight against you with where you want to take us. We pray that we would welcome you by our side. We pray that we would be always ever mindful that when we're in a jam and we're in a pickle, that you're there. Whether it be a test or a trial, you're there. You've taken us there. And even if our sin has taken us there, you're still there. And you're there to get us out of that situation. Thank you. Thank you so, so much for your eternal love. We don't know where we would be without it. Thank you that you became sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Thank you so much for Calvary. Thank you so much for reaching down and meeting us where we were at, and wanting to transform us into the likeness of Christ. Mind-boggling, overwhelming, transforming, and just bless you for it. Father, want to intercede for the Johnson family this morning. Great, great needs. Keith with his health situation, and especially Sam. Father, I continue to pray for a miracle. Done that all week. Pray that you would touch Sam's body. There's nothing that you can't do. We don't know what you're doing in this situation. We know you're at work. We don't always see the end from the beginning or the beginning from the end, but you see it all. And we ask for your will to be done, and we pray that you, as a God of miracles, would touch Sam in his heart, in his mind, in his body, his legs. We ask that you would restore to him, Lord, what the locusts have eaten. So we give Sam to you. Lift up Helen. We thank you for the continued healing with her foot. Thank you that she was able to be out last night at the meeting and participate. So we lift her up this morning. Also, Bob Ganaway, we pray that you would touch him, that he might feel better. Give you the many others, Lord, that aren't here today out of fear for the virus, out of personal struggles, whether it be struggles with family or within their own hearts or minds. Those that are shut in, that can't make it because of they don't drive or cold weather, we give them to you. And we ask, Father, that you would, again, touch them, encourage them, speak to their hearts, and do exceedingly abundantly above all that they could ask or think, that they could imagine with the situations that they're faced with, that they're confronted with. Thank you that you, Lord, constantly live to make intercession for us. What a marvelous, marvelous truth. And we thank you for that. May we own that, understand it, seek to ponder, and treasure that thought. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, we have scripture reading. Dave.
this morning's first scripture reading from the New Testament, from Luke's Gospel, the 10th chapter, reading verses 30 through 37. And if you're using a church Bible, that can be found on page 932. Again, the 10th chapter of Luke's Gospel, verses 30 through 37. Jesus replied and said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among robbers, and they stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. And by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite also, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan who was on a journey came upon him, and when he saw him, he felt compassion. And he came to him and bandaged up his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them, and he put him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper and said, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend when I return, I will repay you.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell to the robber's hands?" And he said, "The one who showed mercy toward him." Then Jesus said to him, "Go and do the same." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Thanks, Dave. Our next song, "One Thing Remains." Please stand.
Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my
may be seated.
Our second reading this morning is also from the book of Luke, the 17th chapter, verses 11 through 19, and that is found on page 940 of the Church Bible. While he was on the way to Jerusalem, he was passing between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 leprous men who stood at a distance met him. And they raised their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they were going, they were cleansed. Now one of them, when he saw that he had been healed, turned back, glorifying God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at his feet, giving thanks to him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered and said, "Were there not 10 cleansed? But the 9, where are they? Was no one found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Stand up and go. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, in my weakness this morning, may you be made strong, give you this time and what you've laid upon my heart. May you be pleased to open it up to the hearts of your people. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. So folks, I've said this in the past and I'll say it again. You know, when I was back in school, I wasn't very fond of math, probably because I didn't do too well at it. I hated it. But there are some things I did remember, like, for example, this expression, you know, the lowest common denominator. Remember when you were working on fractions, you know, large fractions, you would have to find the lowest common denominator because it would simplify, you know, the equation, right? It's probably, I don't know if it's used in other, Bill, you might know, people who've had calculus or things like that. I don't know if you have to use the lowest common denominator in more complex solutions, right? But it's interesting because that expression is not only used with math, but it's actually used socially. It's about catering to the level of the least discriminating audience or consumer group. It's interesting how they use that, you know, from a marketing perspective. The lowest level of the least discriminating audience or consumer group. Now, I actually use it in a slightly different way. I always say, you know, people are playing to the lowest common denominator, and I always refer to it as, like, you know, usually in terms of morals or effort, you know, that kind of thing. Just going through the motions, not really doing it to their fullest. Right? Not bringing their A game, so to speak. There's another expression, too. I was sharing this with Helen last night. Have you ever heard the expression, a race to the bottom? Have you ever heard that expression? A number of years ago, I was looking for a microwave, and we had gotten a microwave at Cahan's Furniture, because they, you know, they sell, when they were over there, they sold appliances. Unfortunately, now it's a cannabis dispensary, but But when Steve Cahillan was over there, I called him up one day and was looking. I actually got Steve on the phone, not that I knew the guy personally, but very nice gentleman. And I think they're down in Plymouth now. But I inquired about a microwave, and he said, we stopped selling that years ago, those items years ago. He said, you know, they were of such low quality, and it was actually a race to the bottom. and basically what he said was, to sell a microwave was just a waste of his time, you know, with all the haggling, and, you know, it just wasn't even worth his energy. And he was basically saying that he chose to sell higher-end product. So patronize Cahillans. So it's not about quality so much today as it is about making money. You know, we see a kind of a race to the bottom with people's work ethic today, do we not? They don't really have their whole heart and their soul into it. They don't bring their A game. They don't really seem to care. It's almost like the lowest common denominator. Whatever the lowest I can. See, in math, that's a good thing. But, you know, in socially speaking, it's not a good thing, you see? Just enough to get by. You've probably heard of another familiar expression. It's the letter of the law versus the spirit of the law. This idea actually comes out of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, which I'd like to read for you. But the Apostle Paul writes to the Corinthians, and you have to understand 2 Corinthians because, you know, the Apostle Paul established and ministered at that church, and Aquila and Priscilla later came on and helped with that work. And the Corinthians, we said this before, they're a troubled church. Well, later they're questioning the Apostle Paul's apostolic authority. They're questioning his authority. And, you know, he's trying to explain to them how they ministered. And he said in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 5, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God. Oh, I love that. Who also made us adequate as servants of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the spirit. For the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. And so in church, we talk about the letter of the law versus the spirit of the law. The letter kills, but the spirit gives life. So the way we would probably want to understand this is when you talk about the spirit of the law, you're actually looking at the more deeper hidden meaning to the letter of the law, or the reason why the letter of the law was given. Whereas the letter of the law is, you know, you interpret it as very exact in its meaning, right? Without regard to any deeper meaning. So when you think about the letter of the law, it's almost kind of baseline, not going the extra mile. The spirit of the law would be going the extra mile. I started to think on this, and there's many, many examples in Scripture where we can extract this principle between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. Because remember, the letter of the law kills, but the spirit gives life, right? So when you come to Luke's gospel with the account of the 10 lepers, I'm going to suggest to you that you see the principle here of the letter of the law versus the spirit of the law. 9 followed the letter of the law, and they ran off to show themselves to the priest. But only 1 followed the spirit of the law, and he came back, and he fell down at Jesus' feet, and he worshiped before he showed himself to the high priest. Do you see the difference? The one leper went the extra mile, and what he did was in his heart. What was in his heart came out of his heart, and he was so excited, and he rejoiced, and he praised God, and he was so thankful. As they were going along, he saw that he was transformed. And that's what came out of his heart. But all the other ones are running down the path And they're just entrapped by the letter of the law. They didn't thank or praise God. They were excited, but they didn't thank or praise God. If you think about the letter versus the spirit, it really comes down to one's understanding of what is more pleasing to God. Now, you folks know this. I'm assuming that you know it, but somebody said never assume that people know, you know, when you get up and speak here. But in Galatians, the Apostle Paul said that the law was to be a tutor to lead us to Christ. Everything that was written in the Old Testament under the law was to point us ultimately to Christ. And so the letter of the law kills. It puts us all under judgment. You know, when the giving of the law was given at Mount Sinai, it was a word from God, it was life, but in the sense that it was God's standards and ideal, but it killed because nobody meets that ideal. And the law is very unforgiving, and it brings a charge against us all. And when you go throughout the Old Testament, the law always has commands and demands, does it not? But what's the deeper meaning behind all that? And the deeper meaning was always striving to love the Lord your God with your whole heart, whole soul, whole mind, whole strength. It was always the standard of perfection. And not just simply doing things rotely or going through the motions. You know, we're as people, we're great for going through the motions, are we not? We really are. And so what happens is doing can become a process. Doing is the process. But it doesn't always necessarily mean that deep down you're excited about doing it. You know, remember when you were a kid, your mom would say, oh, could you take out the trash? It's like, yeah, I'll do it. Right? Been there, done that. We still get that occasionally. And you're not too excited about doing it. There are some things that you have to do every day that you're not too excited about. Yeah, I'll do it. And yet the scripture says, whatever you do in word or deed, do it unto the Lord, right? And we forget that. We forget that. And we do it kind of in a rote manner, and we do it begrudgingly. And yet, it's not about the doing so much as it is the substance of the heart. That's the issue here. Thank God, when Christ came from heaven, he just didn't say, okay, I'll just go to the cross. I'll do it. But he did it to the full. It was great joy and great pleasure to go to the cross. Now, Gethsemane was a difficult time, but he would do it all over again. Thank God he doesn't have to do it all over again. But he did it in the fullness of not only the doing, but to the deepest recesses of his heart and his soul. And that's the difference between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. I want to come back to the story of the 10 lepers, but before I do, I actually want to point out some other examples in Scripture which I really never saw before, but actually always create this tension between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. For example, take the parable of the Good Samaritan that Dave read a little bit earlier. Great, great parable. Well, if you take a look at it in Luke chapter 10 in its context, there was this Pharisee who comes along and he wants to test Jesus. And so he asks about the greatest commandment, and Jesus says, you know, love your Lord your God with your whole heart, soul, mind, and love your neighbor as yourself, right? And so the scripture says, wanting to justify himself as to who knew who his neighbor was, you see, he says, so who is my neighbor? And that's the context in which Jesus tells the parable of the Good Samaritan. And it's interesting because you know that his neighbor was only that person of his tribe. Now, we talked about that in Sunday school this morning. You know, the whole idea of tribalism. This Pharisee saw the Jewish people as his neighbor. That's it. You know, those within the Jewish community. And anything outside of that would not be his neighbor. And so when Jesus tells the parable, you've got the priest that walks by the wounded guy. You've got the Levite that walks by the wounded. And then you all of a sudden you have the Samaritan come along who is kind of not the Pharisee's neighbor. That's not how he understands it. And Jesus says, yeah, he is. You see? And so the Pharisee was of the letter of the law. Oh, my neighbor is somebody who literally lives next to me or my fellow Jew in the community. Nothing outside of that, you see? And obviously Jesus was pointing out the Pharisaical attitude because he had an attitude which was of the letter of the law, right? It would almost be like, you know, asking your kids to take out the trash. But as they're taking out the trash, they don't pick up the trash in the yard as they walk to the trash can. I'll just take out the trash, you see. And so it's a very, very myopic view. It's a very, very narrow view. It's tunnel vision. That's the letter of the law, right? You come over to the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 through 7. A lot of people don't understand the Sermon on the Mount, but Jesus basically articulates a lot of Old Testament law and the letter, but then he talks about the spirit of the law, you see? For example, a famous expression in chapter 5, Jesus would say, you have heard it said. This was in reference to the letter of the law. But then he would say, but I say to you. And see, he was going and pointing to the spirit of the law. So for example, when you have murder, you know, the letter of the law is, well, I didn't kill my brother. But Jesus said, well, yeah, you're angry at him. Or you hate your brother. And you see, so that is, the letter of the law would be murder. The higher idea is, wait a minute, get rid of the anger and the hate. Adultery, the same thing. Well, I don't commit adultery, but do you lust? And that's the higher level of meaning behind the written letter. Making vows. Here you go. Loving your friend. It's easy to love my friend, but what about loving my enemy, you see? And so Jesus is articulating the letter of the law, but then saying, you know, as his people, we need to go beyond the letter of the law. You also see this principle with the rich man who comes to Jesus, and he says, you recall the story, he says, how might I get eternal life? Because I've kept all the commandments from the time I've been a little kid. And you know, Jesus said, go sell your possessions, give them to the poor, and come follow me. And the scripture says that the rich man put his head down and walked away very sad. It wasn't that Jesus was saying, give all your money away to the poor people. Jesus was going after the deeper issue of, okay, you've kept all these commandments, but I want your heart, you see? I want what's in here rather than just the doing. And we assume that the guy never came back to Jesus, which would be sad. He walked away sad, but he couldn't get to the point where he gave his heart to Christ. And that's what God wanted all along. Not his riches to the poor, but his heart. We see this principle of letter versus spirit in giving, do we not? Here you go. God loves a cheerful giver. He doesn't want us to give begrudgingly, you see? So the letter would be, okay, I'm going to give, and you throw something in the plate. But, you know, giving it cheerfully is another story. Also, we see this with the Pharisee and the publican. I absolutely love this. Two go into the temple, and the Pharisee stands there and he says, Father, I thank you that I am not like this other guy. I tithe and I do this and I do this and I do that. And yet, The publican is on the other side, and he won't even look up, and he's saying, God, forgive, beating his chest, God, forgive me. I'm a sinner. And when you read the account, who was going through the motions? And who was broken? Who was doing and didn't really understand the heart issues of it? And who understand the heart issues of it and was broken? And the scripture says that Jesus said that the publican walked away justified because the Pharisee held to the letter of the law. He never captured the spirit of it. He was self-righteous, you see. The Apostle Paul also wrote about do's and don'ts in Colossians. Let me read a passage for you. You might want to even turn there, several verses. Colossians chapter 2, verses 20 through 23. This is a section about do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. And it was basically trying to get the Colossians to get away from the doing so much of the Old Testament ceremonial or the dietary codes of the law. Apostle Paul writes to the church at Colossae, if you have died with Christ to the elementary principles of the world, why, as if you were living in the world, do you submit yourself to decrees such as do not handle, do not taste, do not touch, which all refer to things destined to perish with the using, in accordance with the commandments and the teachings of men? These are matters which have to be for sure the appearance of wisdom in self-made religion and self-abasement and severe treatment of the body, but are of no value to fleshly indulgence. And so what you have here is people holding to the letter of the law, not the spirit of the law. It's not the dietary things that make a person unclean. What did God say to Peter? You can eat all things. Go for it. You can eat meat if you want. You can not eat meat if you want. You can be a vegan if you want. You cannot be a vegan. You know, and the whole thing is like live and let live and not hold to the letter, which kills, you see? It kills the environment. And all these things don't make you right with God. You know, if you choose not to have a drink, that doesn't make you right with God, just like having a drink doesn't make you right with God. Or not eating pork versus eating pork, you see? And we get so hung up in our churches about all the letter of the law. Now, just an important thing here. Paul's talking about the dietary, the ceremonial things of the law. He's not talking about the moral code of the law, because the Ten Commandments still apply. He's saying just don't get hung up in all these do's and don'ts about eating and drinking, because he said that the Romans, the kingdom of God, is not about that. Amen? And yet that's what we do. And so we in our churches sometimes, we project and we actually kill the spirit of people in terms of their freedom in Christ. So as I look at the whole principle of the letter of the law and the spirit of the law, it's about doing, but it's going beyond the doing. Ultimately, it's a desire and a willingness to go deeper. It's a desire to not play to the lowest common denominator, but to do everything with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Do it to the best of my ability. We've lost that in this country. Oh my goodness, you talk about a race to the bottom. It's insane. It's not about exact literal words. And that's the point here. Here you go. I came across that somebody used this as an example. For example, a little child comes home from school and their mother tells them, do not watch TV until you finish your homework. Well, a few minutes later, his mother finds him watching cartoons on his tablet. And the mother's really upset. And the child says, well, you just told me not to watch TV before I do my homework, you see? But so what they do is they take it right to the letter of the law. Okay, so you told me not to watch TV before I do homework, but I'm going to watch cartoons on my tablet before I do homework, you see? Always kind of twisting and manipulating and exactness. And I think God was trying to get the people away from all that. I think he's trying to get us away from all that. It's about doing things in spirit and in truth, ultimately. Here you go. Here's one. These people worship me with their lips, but their heart's from me, far from me. You see, the letter, I'm here to worship, but man, the heart and the mind is just so far away, you see. We see this letter of the law and the spirit principle in forgiving. So should I forgive seven times? 70 times? Seven times 70? And of course, you know, the answer is no, it's way more than that. It's infinity, right? I came across a great story earlier in the week, actually right here in Massachusetts. There's an electrician in Woburn, maybe you've heard of this, an electrician in Woburn who was asked by an elderly lady if he could take a look at this light fixture in her home because apparently it had burned out. The bulb was burned out, the wiring was all, you know, was toast. And so he gets into the house, and he was actually appalled by what he found. Not only was that light fixture bad, but he looked all over the place, and plaster, an old home, plaster was coming off the walls where you could actually see the lathe, right? Where they pressed the plaster into the lathe years ago when they made the old homes. And so eventually, it led to him not only addressing that light, he rewired the whole house. He rewired the entire house, top to bottom, and he got several other crews to come in and fix the whole house up for this lady, top to bottom, because she was living in squalor. He was absolutely appalled of it. And he didn't have the money, nor did the contractors, but they did it all free of charge. He started a GoFundMe page, raised over $100,000. The lady's name is Gloria, and so what he did was he started this chapter called Glorious Gladiators, and now he got the 2020 Humanitarian Award. It hit the local, national, and regional news, and but rather than just fixing the light fixture, he did the whole house. And they did not take a penny for it. All the money that was raised, all the labor was free, just went to materials. That's a great example of from the letter to the spirit of the law. Back to the 10 lepers real quickly, because I just want to make a couple of additional observations. So it's fair to say that the 9 lepers missed the spirit of the law. They were excited, they showed themselves to the priest, but they missed out on a great blessing. And what was that blessing? To come and fall at the feet of Jesus and to thank him for what he did for them. You see, they did the doing part, but they missed the spontaneity of the spirit part. You know? And that's really, really tragic. You know, going through the doing part and yet missing the great joy and the spontaneity of the spirit part. I was reading somebody who had an interesting take on this. I want to share this because I think it's spot on. If you look at the 10 leper story, from all apparent appearances, this one leper appeared to be disobedient. Jesus told them, go show yourself to the priest. And so the 9 run off, and you would say, oh, well, the 9. If you didn't know the rest of the story that he fell at Jesus' feet, this one, you would think the one was disobedient because he didn't listen to Jesus. And yet, who was the one who ultimately fulfilled the entire law. He did the doing, but in his heart of hearts, he just poured out praise to God. And that was the fulfillment, if you will, from the letter to the Spirit. The other nine, they missed it. And so when you look at it, you say, well, the one was disobedient, and the other nine appeared to be obedient. And that's a funny thing, is it not? I was reflecting on this, but if you go throughout the scriptures, much of Christ's ministry was really teaching people to really get beyond the letter of the law, because it's way more than that, is it not? It's the Spirit of the law that's the true fulfillment of it, because it's the Spirit that brings life. And I would just want to say this, people who embrace rules and regulations, it's almost like, you know, being a child, you know, where you really never ever grow up, you know? You're so bound by all these rules and regulations. And often these very people, they lack freedom, they lack liberty, they lack security in their own relationship to God. And so what they do is they project. Well, you have to do that, and you have to. No, you don't. You know, when Harold Perry was failing, I said, Harold, God can't love you any more if you don't do, than if you do. You see? God's not going to love you less if you don't serve on a committee, and he's not going to love you more if you do. He wants you to serve. But, you know, you be led as to how, and by him as to how you might share and invest and involve yourself. But you know, I think it's sad because I think a lot of people don't frequent churches anymore because so many times people project where they're at in their spiritual walk to somebody else, and they want them to be at where they're at. You know, I leave that to God, right? I don't play the role of the Holy Spirit. We're not to play the role of the Holy Spirit. God will shepherd and bring those people along. But this projecting is not really, really good. And if you try to explain yourself to these people, they don't understand it. You can't argue, you can't defend what you do. If the priests were there, they would probably criticize the one for running back and falling and praising and falling at the feet of Jesus. And yet he was Spirit-led, was he not? These are legalists in our churches. These are people that would call perhaps me a heretic, a blasphemer, a lost soul, because I don't do their Christianity the way they see their Christianity. That's the standard for everybody. And they probably would see me as someone who's gone the way of Cain and Balaam and Judas, you know, because I don't follow rules and regulations, you know, eating and drinking and all that dietary stuff. It damages people in our churches. I knew a lady years ago from the church in Philadelphia. She was brought up in such austere form of Christian living. She rejected all of it for 40 years. And it ruined her life. Praise God, she came back and she was a great, great saint. Oh, Phyllis was incredible. But that kind of Christianity damages people and keeps them away from the church. So, real quickly, as I look at this here, this one leper got it and the other nine did not. And if you take a look at, consider being a leper in this culture. You're a pariah. You're a social outcast. You're someone who has to yell, Jesus, Jesus. You have to keep your distance. Jesus, Jesus. And he's limited where he had to go and what he could do and in his ability to do. And this whole thing just freed him right up. He's clean. And he comes running and falling down. And I say to you, if you look at this passage here, who is the one who's free? The nine or the one? And that's, it's an amazing thing. And it's always pointed out that Jesus never rebuked him for coming off the path and falling down at his feet. So in closing here, there's an irony of ironies. The one who appeared to break the law actually carried it out in its fullest sense of the spirit of the law. And the nine who gave the appearance of keeping the law and the letter of the law were actually in violation of stifling it. Isn't that amazing? Amazing thing. So hopefully this challenges us to think, you know, are we carrying out the letter of the law or the spirit of the law? I don't know about you, but I want to be like this one leper. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the incredible wisdom of your word, the depths of it, the amazing aspects of it. And we pray that we wouldn't be Christians that are the letter of the law when it comes to doing and issues of food and drink and legalism. We pray that we would embrace the spirit of the law and be like this one leper in the fullest sense, where we fall down at your feet and we find freedom, we find praise, and we find the Lord Jesus Christ in all his glory. Thank you for our time today, for each heart that's here, for each heart that might be watching. May we find the freedom that was always meant to be found in you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm missing Bob Ganaway already. Number 504, Without Him. Does that have a message? This song have a message in it. 504, Without Him, please stand.
Jerry Hartgrove, would you close us in a word of prayer today, please?
Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we do thank Thee for the life and love You have shown us and the way to salvation for good. May we make the right choice in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Have a great week.
I told her. It's happening.